Dear friend, in this course, I will be teaching concepts of linear algebra, which are important in engineering point of view. And let us start with the fundamentals of linear algebra. And as and when required, I will be explaining you how these concepts are useful in engineering applications. So let us see the first terminology, Cartesian product. To define Cartesian product, we require set or sets. So let us consider that we are having two set, set A having element A comma B, set B having element C comma D. Then Cartesian product of these two set is written as A cross B is equal to, here every element of this set will be a pair, A cross B. So first element of set A and first element of set B, then first element of set A, second element of set B, then second element of set A and first element of set B, and then last element of set A and last element of set B. So this is Cartesian product of two sets A and B. So here A and B, they were having element, their elements were scalars, but in this case each element is pair of two scalars. So this is the Cartesian product of two sets. Okay, now we'll define term binary operation. After having definition of Cartesian product with our hand, now let us see the definition of binary operation. Here also we require one non-empty set. Let G be any non-empty set. Then star is called as binary operation on the set G. See, I am defining binary operation. To define binary operation, we require one non-empty set. This non-empty set should follow some structure. In that case, we can say that star is a binary operation. So now then star is called as binary operation on the set G if star is a mapping, star is a mapping from your set G cross G to G. The meaning hereby is I am picking one element from set G, another element from set G. Result of this binary operation is falling in the set G itself. Choose one element from here, perform this operation. The result of the operation should fall in the same set. Then star is called binary operation on the set G. So also we can say that G is close with respect to star. G is close with respect to star. So what I said, I am saying you take the set G, pick up one element from set G, and again pick up the element from the same set. So here you are having pair. On that pair, you are performing this operation, and the result of operation is falling in the same set. Then we can say that star is close with respect to this set is close with respect to star. G is close with respect to star, or star is called as binary operation. For example, if I consider set of natural number is close with respect to addition. Let us consider the set G or set, let us consider set n, set of natural number is closed with respect to addition. Let us see this. Addition is pure addition, true addition. So n cross n, two natural numbers, I am picking one natural number from here and one natural number from here and performing addition, the result of addition is also a natural number. So we can say that plus is a binary operation on the set n. N is closed with respect to plus. Now let us consider the another example, minus r cross r. I am doing subtraction, and result of subtraction, if it is falling in the same set, r is the set of real number, and if I pick up one real number from here, another real number from here, and perform subtraction, subtraction of two real number is always a real number. So r is also closed with respect to plus. The set r is, and this plus is a binary operation on the set r. Okay, is there any example which will give you that it is not closed with respect to particular operation? Let us consider that set of integer and operation is division. So set of integer, z is a set of integer, and result is not falling in z. If I pick up any two elements, one from here, one from here, let us say 2 is from here and 3 is from here, 2 by 3, that is not a number in the set of integer. So here I am talking about operation division, and set is integer. So z cross z, and this division is a mapping from z cross z to z. So we can say that this division is not a binary operation on the set z, because z is a set of integer, and if I am dividing two integers, I will not be getting integer. That is quite obvious. So division is not a binary operation on the set z. Let us take the set of natural number again, and we'll see with respect to subtraction whether it is following the rule of binary operation or not. So if I take two natural number, let us say 2 from here and 3 from here, 2 minus 3, result is 1, minus 1. So minus 1 is not a natural number. So minus is not a binary operation on the set n. N is a set of natural number which starts from 1, and if I take 3 from here, 10 from here, 3 minus 10, result is minus 7. Minus 7 is not a natural number. So subtraction is not a binary operation on the set n, where n is set of natural number. So after understanding the definition of Cartesian product and binary operation, let us understand what is group. For group also we need to have a non-empty set. Okay, let G be any non-empty set. Non-empty set means set having elements, that is called maybe one or two, whatever may be elements, but it should have elements. Let G be a non-empty set. Let star be a binary operation on the set G, that is star is a mapping from G cross G to G, or G is closed with respect to star. So what we are assuming, we are having one set which is non-empty set, and another thing is we are saying that star is a binary operation on that set G. So G is closed with respect to star, then G can be called as group. if following things are satisfied, then G is called group. G is called group if star is satisfying following. Star is satisfying following. Right? We are having set G. We are having binary operation, and then set G is called group if star is satisfying following properties. Number one. Associativity. What is that? We have to check here. Let A, B, C belonging to G, or we can say that A star B star C is equal to A star B star C for all A comma B comma C belonging to G. So if I do operation in this fashion, first B C and whatever result comes, that is with A, or first A and B and whatever result comes with C, we are getting the same result, then we say that it is associative operation. Star is associative. Okay, now next thing is existence of identity. There exist, and here this symbol is there exist and element E belonging to G. There exist element E belonging to G. See, this is there exist an element E belonging to G. There is a symbol called such that A star E is equal to E star A is equal to A for all A belonging to G. This is symbol called belonging. So existence of inverse means if I pick up any element in this any element from say G, and if I perform this star on that element, I should get the same element. Then it is called, E is called identity element. There exists an element E belonging to G such that A star E is equal to E star A is equal to A for all A belonging to G. So this is the second requirement for saying G is group, right? This is the second requirement for saying G is a group with respect to star. Now third requirement. G will be called as group if 1, 2, 3 they are satisfied. Third, existence of inverses. There exists an element A inverse belonging to G for every A belonging to G. There exists an element A inverse for every A belonging to G such that this is symbol for such that. So A star A inverse is equal to A inverse A is equal to E. So existence of inverses, there has to be an element corresponding to each element. If I do their operation, I should get E for each A belonging to. So we can also write this clearly: for each A belonging to G, there exists A inverse such that A star A inverse is equal to A inverse A star is equal to E. Okay, if properties 1, 2, 3 they are satisfied, then we can say that the G is the group with respect to star. G is called group with respect to star. So if this group satisfying one more property, commutativity, then we can say that it is abelian group. Commutativity A star B is equal to B star A for all A comma B belonging to G. So this is commutative property. If properties 1, 2, 3 satisfied, it is called group. And if fourth, fourth is also satisfied, then G is called abelian group. Abelian is the name of the person. So if these four properties are satisfied, G is group with respect to star. If all four properties they are satisfied by the G with respect to star, then G is called abelian group. The first property is this star should be associative. Then existence of identity with respect to star, existence of inverses with respect to star, and then star is commutative. Then G is called abelian group with respect to star. So G comma star is an abelian group. So we can say like this: star is also important and set is also important. Set with operations with respect to star, four operations with respect to star, all those things are satisfied, then we can say that it is group. Now let us see one more definition to understand another concept called field. So algebraic structure. Set with one or more binary operations are called algebraic structure. Let us say set n plus, it is one algebraic structure. N is closed with respect to this. Set with one or more algebraic operation is called structure. So that's algebraic structure. R is closed with respect to addition as well as with respect to subtraction. So another algebraic structure. Let us say this one, Z is also closed with respect to addition and subtraction. Z is a set of integer. R is a set of real number. So R is also closed with respect to addition and multiplication. So R is closed. It is also one of the structure. So structure, algebraic structure means set with one or more binary operation is called algebraic structure. Okay, now let us use this for defining one more structure from the linear algebra. That structure is called field, F-I-E-L-D, field. For defining this, we need two sets and we need one set but more binary operations. So let, again it should be a non-empty set, let F be any non-empty set. So F is a set having some elements. Okay, let F is closed with respect to plus called addition and dot called multiplication. Plus and dot. Let F be any non-empty set. Let f is closed with respect to plus, that is addition, and f is closed with respect to dot, that is multiplication. This addition and multiplication can have different meaning also. And if it is not told, they have usual meanings, and if their definition is defined, they have different meanings also. So f is called field with respect to plus and dot if these operations satisfying following postulates, right? For defining field, we need one set and we need two operations, dot and plus. Dot can have, you can have any meaning for dot, and you can have any meaning for plus. Plus can be plus, dot can be multiplication, but you can define their meaning as per your requirement. So let us see what are the things this plus and dot should satisfy. First, see what are the things plus should satisfy. Addition should satisfy. Let us see the things which are to be satisfied by operation plus. Okay, the first property is, again, addition should be associative. That is, a plus b plus c is equal to a plus b plus c for all a, b, c belonging to f. If I take any three elements from the set f, if I do addition like this, b plus c first, and result is added to a, so whatever result I get here in LHS, the same result I should get in the RHS. Then that addition, add, that plus is associative. Okay, so then second property it should satisfy is existence of additive inverse. Before inverses, let us take additive identity. So this additive identity is, so it is like this: for every a belonging to f, there exists an element in f such that a plus that element equal to a. Okay, so this can be written in the different fashion. There exists an element 0 belonging to f such that a plus 0 is equal to 0 plus a is equal to a for all a belonging to f. So existence of additive identity. So 0 is the additive identity. For multiplication, 1 is multiplicative identity. So if that 0 is added to any element of the set F, we get that element, and that element is from the set F. Every A belonging to F, if I add additive element, additive identity, then result will be A only. And this is true for all A belonging to F. Now, third property with respect to addition is existence of additive inverses. So for each a belonging to g, sorry, f is the set which we have taken, belonging to f, there exists, this is symbol for there exists a inverse belonging to f. It should be from set f only. There exists a inverse belonging to f such that such that A plus A inverse is equal to A inverse plus A is equal to what? 0. What is A inverse in case of additive? A inverse of A inverse equal to minus A. That is, it's A ka inverse. A inverse of A is minus A. So A minus A is 0. Or minus A plus A is 0. So A inverse in case of addition is minus A. A inverse in case of multiplication is 1 by A. Because in case of multiplication, the result should be 1. And in case of addition, result should be 0. So what is the fourth property which this plus should satisfy? That is commutative. Addition should be commutative. So what I am saying is A plus B is equal to B plus A for all A, B belonging to F. If I take any two elements of the set F, if I do addition, right addition and left addition, the addition should be same. All these four properties, if it is satisfied, then F is, with respect to addition, F is satisfying these properties, then this F becomes what? F plus is an abelian group. Abelian group. So these are the properties of abelian group. So F should satisfy the properties of abelian group. I'm just writing, this is not part of this, but how to remember these four properties? If I say F is abelian, so F has commutative property, F is satisfying the what? Identity, existence of inverses, and commutative property. That addition is satisfying all those four properties, then this is called F plus is a abelian group. All these four statements can be written in one line. That is, F plus is an abelian group. Now, with respect to multiplication, okay? With respect to multiplication, we'll see. Multiplication, the fifth property, multiplication, that dot should be, that dot should be, what we can say is associative. So that is A dot B is equal to associative. A dot B dot C is equal to A dot B dot C. Here dot is, I am saying, multiplication for all A, B, C belonging to F. Dot should be associative. So next operation is existence of identity. So existence of identity. For multiplication, what is the identity? Identity element is 1, right? So multiplication identity is 1. So existence of identity. Existence of identity. So there exists one belonging to F such that A dot 1 is equal to 1 dot A is equal to A for all A belonging to F. There exists an unit, okay, 1, it's a scalar, 1 belonging to F. There exists a 1 in F such that 1 multiplied by any element of the set, we should get same element for all A belonging to F. You can take any element of set F, multiply that by 1, the result should be A. So this is called as existence of multiplicative identity. Now let us go for seventh postulate, which is to be satisfied. So multiplicative inverses. So for each element A belonging to F, there exists an element A inverse such that a into a inverse is equal to a inverse into a is equal to 1, that is which is the element of f which is requirement, that is multiplicative identity. Result should be multiplicative identity. So if there is 2, the inverse is 1 by 2. If there is 2 in the set f, then 1 by 2 must be the element of the set f. If there is 9 in the set f, then there must be 1 by 9 in the set f, then only this property will be satisfied. This is existence of multiplicative inverses. And eighth property, again, and that is with respect to multiplication, dot is commutative. You can write multiplication is commutative or dot is commutative. That means a dot b is equal to b dot a for all a b belonging to f. So this is four properties with respect to addition, four properties with respect to multiplication, and one more property which joins addition and multiplication, that is ninth property. We can write a dot b plus c is equal to a dot b plus a dot c for all a b c belonging to f. Okay, if all these nine properties satisfied, then f plus dot is called field. So f is called field. So this is definition of field. The field can also be this one represented in short form, that is what I said, 1 to 4, that is represented by abelian group. So the field, will try to remember this in the form of group. The first is f comma plus should be abelian group. Then we can say that f minus 0 dot is abelian group. Okay, and the last property, third property, is a dot b dot c is equal to a dot b dot c for all a comma b comma c. Okay, elements of f, they are called scalars. So if I remember these three statements, from these three statements we can generate all those nine statements. This corresponds to four properties. This corresponds to four property. Mind well, here f minus o, that element, it is the inverses, they are existing for only non-zero element of f. In case of multiplication, for each a belonging to f, there exists a inverse to, we say, 1. Okay, if that a is non-zero element of f, the inverses are existing for non-zero elements of f. That is the requirement for the field. So for addition, inverses are existing for all elements of f, but multiplication, the inverses are existing for non-zero elements of f. Every non-zero element of f, there exists a inverse such that a dot a inverse is equal to 1. So this is the definition of field. So elements of fields, we say they are scalars. So by using all these concepts, we will define another term which is called vector space, but it will be explained in the next video.